Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Mesa Place Church. We are so, so excited that you are here with us today. And we're very excited because we're going to be doing something very special this morning. My name is Amy Sinceri, and this is my husband, Paul Sinceri. And we are members of the core team that actually helped to plant this church. So we are just very, very glad that you are here with us this morning and excited. So it is our absolute privilege that we are going to be baptizing our daughter. I knew I was going to cry a little bit. Our daughter, Alexa Lynn, this morning. And we're also going to be, Pastor Christian is going to be baptizing one of our members, Rudy, as well this morning. So before we baptize, yes, give them a hand. Before we have our baptism candidates come forward and join us, I first would just like to share with you all what baptism even is, what it means, and why we should be baptized, because I know a lot of times there's some confusion with that. You see, in God's word, baptism is one of the two ordinances that Jesus tells us that we should do once we have asked him to be our Savior. So this is once we've accepted Jesus into our heart, with all of our mind, our body, our spirit, our soul, we have accepted him to be our Savior. The first ordinance Jesus tells us to do is baptism, which Alexa and Rudy are going to be doing today. The second ordinance that Jesus tells us to do after, again, we have accepted him is communion. That is why here at Mesa Place Church, we really try to highlight these two ordinances because it shows that we are being obedient. We are being obedient to what Jesus, what he tells us to do. If you have any questions about this, baptism, anything like that, you can get with Pastor Christian afterwards or one of our leaders. Okay, at this point, I'm going to ask that the baptism candidates please make their way forward. Alexa and Rudy, you can join us up front. And as they make their way up front, you can see that they are holding a light. And Pastor Christian beforehand, he has applied a water and salt solution to their lips. This is because as believers, we are to be the salt and the light of the world, which God tells us to in Matthew 5, 13 through 16. In this moment, I hope you all can see just how rich symbolism is. The salt, the water on their lips, the light they are holding. And of course, the baptism itself, which is a symbol of a burial and a resurrection that we have in Christ. But you know what? All of these are just symbols because the one, the only one that truly saves us is Jesus. Can I get an amen on that?
Amen.
Okay, so now we're going to have Alexa enter the water. Alexa Lynn is 5 years old. She's actually going to be celebrating her 6th birthday next Friday. She is in kindergarten, about to graduate, and let me tell you, this girl is on fire for our Lord Jesus Christ. I have never seen it so deep in a child before, but she loves Jesus so much, and I am so, so proud that she's about to be baptized.
Church, I would rather stand with God and be judged by the world than stand with the world and be judged by God.
Yes.
I'm so grateful today. And my daughter is choosing, she's choosing to stand with God. The love she has for our Lord is truly amazing. Alexa, are you ready to stand with God?
Yeah.
On that confession of faith, in front of all these witnesses, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried with Christ, raised to walk in newness of life.
Woo! All right. And the next we have, well, I'm glad you're here. It's a crowded house. We like crowded houses here at MPC. Next we have Rudy. Rudy's a big old boy. Go ahead. Right over here. There you go. You can sit down, Papa. Get comfortable. You know, I haven't known Rudy very long, but there's just some people that the Lord just kind of highlights and he shows. And you see the mark of the Holy Spirit even before you talk to him. And I'm so grateful for his life. He came and we took him out to lunch. I'm not saying that if you come here, I'm going to take you to lunch, but more maybe, who knows. But we went out to lunch and I just saw in him, this big old boy, this tenderness of heart for the Lord Jesus Christ. And he says, you know, Pastor, what can I do for you or for the church? And I said, well, you asked. And so he made this thing for us back there that we're going to hang up that we'll remember him by. But more importantly, remembering what Rudy did for this church is what he does for his Lord Jesus Christ. And just like Amy said, if you have any questions about this whole baptism communion thing, you're not quite sure, well, that's on you. No, you come talk to me and we'll help you see what it means to walk with Jesus Christ. Rudy, you still mess up, right, Carnal? You see, we all mess up. But it's through the power of Jesus Christ and the obedience that we have to him daily. And so with that, let me get down here. If you hear something popping, that's my bones, okay? I'm an old guy now. Rudy, you love Jesus, don't you? And it's been a hard walk, right? But he's always been there for you. So Rudy, it is my privilege and my honor that you take this step in walking in obedience with the Lord. All those things that you had to go through, all those trials and tribulations, all the fear, the stress, and the anger, and that you're trying to leave behind. You don't have to do it alone anymore, Carnal. It's through the power of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit that empowers you through the will of the Father. And with that, my brother, remember this day. It is my honor to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried with Christ, and raised to walk in the newness of life. Amen. Well, today we're going to continue in our series titled Parakletos. That's those things that are up there. That's the Greek word for the Holy Spirit. And we started this second section of the Holy Spirit with the spiritual fruit. And so just to kind of recap or to review from last Sunday, I don't want you to get confused over this whole thing about gifts of the Spirit and the fruit of the Spirit, okay? They're not the same thing at all. Another thing is that gifts are freely given to us. And they're given to us as a completed condition when you have a gift of the Spirit. While the fruit of the Spirit, listen, is the working out of. It's a process, mainly in our character and in our attitude. You know, an example of a spiritual gift is, of course, salvation, right? You don't think that we're working out to get salvation. We work out our salvation through the fruit. While patience is a fruit that is matured through a process, usually in serving. You know, an example I have of this, some of you are questioning these definitions, those descriptions, and the most simple that comes to mind is this. I can give the top-of-the-line mountain bike to Robert, our head deacon, right? But he will not be a true fanatic, an advocate. He won't be a mountain biker until he starts riding that thing. And not just riding it occasionally, but regularly, right? Same thing with the fruit. You see, the scriptures are very, very clear on this point, and that is that as a Christian, we are to use our gifts to minister to other people. You see, that's why we speak about salvation so much, because it's a gift that we have. And that only comes through the power of the Holy Spirit. And that fruit of the Spirit deals mainly with my attitude. You see, gifts deal with an action in service. All right? Now, I also want to recap from last Sunday's message some very important points to keep in mind as we continue this morning. Last week I mentioned the following, and that is that this list of the Spirit that's found in Galatians chapter 5, which we're going to see in just a bit, but this list of the fruit of the Spirit is a picture. It is a portrait. It's an outline of Jesus Christ, if you look at it. It says love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. You see, that is an outline. It is a picture of the life of Christ here on earth. Second thing, the fruit of the Spirit is about godly character and not about worldly conformity. It's about, listen, in here. It's not about out there. The fruit of the Spirit is about in here. It's not about out there. Third thing, This is probably the most shocking response that I got from last week's message. But the third thing you need to keep in mind, you can't pick and choose which fruit you're going to have that day. Okay? And the fourth thing is that the fruit is not about earthly traits. Okay? Most of us think that they are, right? Because they sound like normal things. Patience, well, I got that. No, you don't. I got joy. Yeah, when you got a new guitar, maybe. You see? Although, we can fake it. That's the problem with this list. You see, we can fake it. But this list is a supernatural thing. Okay? The fifth thing to consider of the fruit of the Spirit is that it is a conditional process of growth to all Christians. See, if you're a Christian, you need to be growing in all these areas. Okay? You can't be saying, I'm going to have self-control today. No, chale, it's everything growing all at once. You see, we are to grow and display this fruit. And last on fruit growing is that it is slow and sometimes painful, but it leads to maturity. Okay, now if you missed any of those sermons or you want to catch up, you can go to our YouTube channel, Mesa Place Church El Paso. Type that in and just go Paracletos. And Jack Dimbicky has been doing a great job. Great job, Papa. I love you, Papito. Thank you for doing that. And so today, I want us to look at this fruit of the Spirit. So let's go into Galatians chapter 5 this morning. Now, if you don't have a Bible, go ahead and raise your hand. We want to make sure you have scripture in your hand. Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 through 23. If you need a Bible in Spanish, go ahead and raise your hand in Spanish and they'll get one to you. It's a slow joke. It'll come to you. Ask for a Bible in Spanish. They'll get you one in Spanish. We're going to be in Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 through 23. It'll be up here on the board here shortly. Or it is already, right? She rocks. Elizabeth and Chloe, you guys do such an awesome job with that stuff. Anyway, it says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. Now, the reason why there is no law, the reason why Paul says that is because this comes from God and not from man, okay? I mean, yeah, that list kind of looks like things that we can do here on earth, and yet we can violate one of those pretty quick, right? When we look at that list in our own human traits, and that is because that list looks an awful like stuff that we do. But you see, the reason there is no law when you display this fruit, when you have this fruit, is because this comes directly from the Holy Spirit as a believer. Now, the law highlights our sin, right? That's what the law does. The only reason to have a law is to show, is to highlight our failure as humans. Isn't that right? You know, I see this every day, and I'm not even speaking about spirituality. You see, let me ask you, so you can kind of put this into your mind, okay? Put on your thinking caps. Right here on the freeway. When do people break the law? When do people break the law? Somebody. When what? What? When you get caught, that's absolutely right. When the cop is around, right? Don't be telling me this stuff, kiske. I don't break the law. Yeah, you do. You only, when the cop's around, right? You even put the, I wasn't texting and driving. Chale. Right? We even as, without being a Christian, we know that we violate the law. The lawgiver's there, right? Es porque la vieja, she had me busy, I was mad. And no, you know when you do it. Don't exceed, right? Stay on the right side of the road. It goes on and on. Don't text, and yet it happens constantly. Well, listen, as believers, Christ is saying in order to be above the law, right? If he's saying there is no law, so in order to be above the law or the consequences of the law, he says, walk in the Spirit. You see? Then you're above the law. That's why Paul in verse 16 and 17 of this same chapter, Paul says, walk in the Spirit and you will not carry out the desire of the flesh. And then he goes on to tell us of this constant battle that is going on between our own will and our own desire. You see, he tells us about this and how those two things are continually, listen to this, in opposition to the work of the Holy Spirit. What two things? Your will and your desire is always fighting against the work of the Spirit in your life. Did you know that? This is why understanding and applying the fruit of the Spirit is such a big deal.
And we will now see this in detail today in the next several Sundays to follow. Today we're going to take a look at the very first fruit that's there of the Spirit, and it is love. You know, something to consider before we move on. Notice, Paul says there, look again, it says, but the fruit of the Spirit. You see, he doesn't say, but the fruits of the Spirit. Not plural, singular. Why? All the fruit, all at once. And the first one on the list is love. Why? You have to ask why. Well, remember, I already mentioned that this fruit of the Spirit is a portrait of Christ. Remember I said that? Now stop and consider this. Stop and look at those things on the list, that spiritual list, as a portrait of Jesus Christ or an outline of Christ. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. You see, listen to me on this. Pay attention. Out of the love of Christ will the other eight characteristics there manifest in you to God's glory. Let me say that again. I don't think y'all listening. Y'all still cold, or I don't know what's going on. You see, listen to me on this. Pay attention. Out of the love of Christ will the other eight characteristics start to manifest in you to God's glory. And why is that? See, you have to always ask why. Don't just listen to me and go, ay, the pastor, qué bonito es. No, listen. Why? 1 John chapter 4, verse 8. Take a look at it. This is the big reason. You don't just believe me. 1 John 4, 8. What did it say? The one who does not love does not know God. Boom, you could stop there. But it continues, Amy, for God is love. See, her little daughter wrote, God is love. That's why I'm getting baptized. Everything out of that comes everything else, the love of God. You see, folks, listen up. If we are imitating Christ, which that child was, which Rudy is, if we are to be growing in the likeness of Christ and we do not love, we are going against the very thing that Christ is, for God is love. Did you see that? So in other words, the marks of a Christian, the signs of Christian maturity and growth, are not found in the gifts of the Spirit, but from the fruit of the Spirit. Can I get an amen? Listen, the gift of salvation, the gifts that are given to us, are not an indication that we're growing. See, just because you're saved doesn't mean that you're growing as a Christian. I can give you accounts of Christians, meaning saved people, believing people, and yet they have no maturity. You see, they walk, they talk, they act on the gifts as a, I'm saved, they'll say, right? They'll say stuff like, pues I know the Bible. But then when they act on the gifts in service to God and others, it's very evident there's no fruit there. They're not growing. You don't believe me? That's okay. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 1 through 2. This is Paul saying this, and he's talking about fruit. I love this. If I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, see that? He's talking about gifts. But do not have love, that's the fruit of the Holy Spirit, I have become, you know what he says? I have become a noisy gong. How shocking was that, right? That's what happens when you speak out of, and you're not using love. It's a distress to people. Second, if I have the gift of prophecy and know all the mysteries and the knowledge, and if I have all the faith so as to move mountains but do not have love, I am nothing. Did you see that? You can have all the gifts that you want. You got to have love. Later on in Corinthians, Paul says, and the greatest of these, faith, hope, and love, is love. The greatest of it is love. So the first one to look at this Sunday, the first fruit to examine in our own lives is love. Today I want us to look at this love in three distinct ways to see so that you can evaluate if you're growing in the spiritual fruit. And let me just make a comment on this spiritual fruit about today's message. Examine your own doggone fruit. Examine your own life. I don't want you to be saying to yourself, oh, I'm so glad so-and-so is here. They're going to, ooh-hoo-hoo. Okay? Oh, man, I wish so-and-so were here. No. You examine your own fruit this morning. So first fruit to examine in your own life, in your own growth is, number one, look there in your outline. You got to examine our love for God. You have to examine your love for God first. Now listen to me. In the Greek, Some of you are familiar with these terms for love. There's eros, right? That's that physical love motivated by pleasure. You have a stergo, that is love motivated by the authority, by title, by position. You have phileo, that's that brotherly love. And then you go to agape, that is the love we are talking about as the fruit of the Spirit. That's the godly love. You see, let me explain something to you. You see, here in the United States, we're very familiar with the word love, right? I love my spouse. I love my bike. I love you when you make enchiladas. You want to get to my heart? Make me enchiladas. No, no onions, okay? But you see, it's the same word used in different ways and different meanings. What we're saying is that I like, I need, I really want, I really love. It's all the same. And so as love being the first spiritual fruit in on the list, let's get some definition. We can't use our own conditional, our own conditioned, predetermined thoughts on love, okay? So this morning, if you could, do me a favor as we examine your own doggone fruit. Let us use love as intended through what is listed. What is intended here? And that is that agape love, love motivated by Christ. So this is a command, not, this is Jesus not saying, I love you, man. This is the Jesus kind of love. Man, I love you. You see the difference? Yes. So let's look at this love for God. You see, I think that some of you who are saved are saved out of fear, right? Saved out of fear. What do you mean, Pastor? Like you heard a message and somebody laid out that if you die today and you don't have Jesus, that you're going to go to hell, and hell is this really, really bad place, and it is. But salvation then becomes a sum on a balance sheet of good things that you should do, and not having Jesus, of course, is a bad thing, right? So you came to faith that way. Then there's a view of, well, having God in your life is good because of that peace thing in your heart. And having God on your side is a good thing. And so then God then kind of becomes like an action that you take, like taking vitamin C in the winter, right? Drinking local bee honey when your allergies start to mess up. Some of you are going like, oh, local bee honey, that'll help. Yes, it does. And then you have those that just kind of do it. They're saved because everyone else did it that they know. And so they must be right. They're all doing it. And let me just say that at some level, all those things, I guess they're good. You know, you're saved. But not what the salvation thing is all about. And some of you have not connected. And it may be why you're having a problem with loving God. You're saved, but, you know, somebody died, and so you're mad. Something happened, and you're mad. You see, you don't have that love. You see, accepting God in your life is not, listen to me, is not the same thing as loving God, even if you just accepted Him. It's not as if this is a separation for only Christians that accept or acknowledge God. In Mark chapter 5 is a great example of this. Jesus, He's out and about, you know, He's doing His Jesus thing. He's out doing His Jesus stuff, miracles. And this dude comes up, he runs up to Jesus with demons and says, Son of the Most High God. He knows that's Jesus. He acknowledges Him. It's not as if the demons kind of change sides right there. They change teams in order to acknowledge or accept Christ. No. As a matter of fact, this love for God is a commandment. Did you know that? Look at Deuteronomy with me, chapter 6, verse 5. Let's look at Deuteronomy 6, 5. If you want, love the Lord your God. See, you must love the Lord your God with your whole mind, your whole being, and all your strength. That is, you must learn to love Him in your thoughts, in your heart, and in your very being. That's body, soul, and mind, people. I like it in the Message translation. Listen to it. In the Message, it says, love God, your God. See, some of you love God, but He's not your God. In the Message, He says, love God, your God. How? It says, with your whole heart. Love Him with all that's in you. Love Him with all you got. Boom, pow. With all you got. You see, this is what separates the goats and the sheep, isn't it? That is what separates those that do and don't. Do and don't do what? Love Him. Love Him. You see, examine your fruit. Do you have a love for God, or do you only acknowledge him? Yeah, he's a cool dude. Do you still have reservations? Do you have doubts and fears or even anger towards God? Examine your condition. You see, God says to you, bring all that junk to me and I will love you. How much? The Lord Jesus Christ says this much and proved it by being crucified on a cross for you. This is how much I love you. And he did so. He saved you while you were still a sinner. Look at 1 John chapter 4, verse 19. Oh, this is so convicting. Why should we love? He says, we love because he first loved us. You see, this love for God is big, and without love for God is why, oh, get ready, I'm about to start preaching here, get ready. If even your gifts and sacrifices to God, even your service here at the church is not yielding to you or to God, and for that matter, any benefit to anybody else. If you don't love God, look at 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 3. I give all my possessions to feed the poor, and if I surrender my body to be burned, but do not have love, it profits me nothing. Why, that poor guy was burned, yeah, but he didn't love God. Nice charcoal, I guess, now. Nothing. See, love as a spiritual fruit starts with love for God. Next thing to examine in our fruit, second, our love for people. It's a little heavier, doesn't it? You've got to examine your love for people. And this is where that whole pruning, the testing process starts to become real. Isn't that right? When you start loving other people. The loving God thing is like, yeah, man, I can see where I need to love God. But this love people thing can be hard, right? Am I the only one? My wife, amen. But this is where the pruning process really takes shape, where our love as a fruit really comes into focus. Can you agape people? That is, can you love people like Christ loves people? Look at John chapter 13, verse 34 and 35. This is Jesus saying this. A new commandment I give to you. Man, I'm telling you something. If the Lord of lords and King of kings says, I'm going to give you a new commandment, y'all better pay attention. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Only the Christians. Didn't say that. That you love one another. Only the ones that help in ministry. That you love one another. Even as I have loved you. That you also love one another. Why? By this, all men will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. I love that. So the first thing we need to do is love God. Then Jesus says, love others. Don't go too far along now. Stay right there where I'm at. Stay on that. Let's look at that for just a bit. You see, Jesus is asked by some religious leaders one day that this is going on. They come up to him and they say, hey, man. Well, okay, they didn't say, hey, man. They were mockingly calling him rabbi. They were calling him teacher. And they called him out. They're trying to make Jesus look and sound like a fool. Bad idea. But anyway, they ask him, which is like the greatest commandment? Which is like the tippy-tippy top and machine? And Jesus says, love God with all you are and love others the same way. Why? Pay attention. Because this agape love is and will take a supernatural act in most cases. So check it out. You see, it's love this way, vertical to God. And then you can start loving horizontally to others. See, y'all didn't listen to me. Oh man, y'all got that bewildered look. How many of you can show your hands. It's okay, no one's going to know you're talking to the person right next to you. How many of you have a difficult person in your life that you deal with? How many of you, show of hands, deal with this person regularly? See? In Jesus' name, I hope I don't offend you, but y'all stupid. See, you know you're going to go and meet that person, and instead of doing something about it, you don't. You say, Lord, I'm going to go talk to this person. Help me love you, and then I can love others. How many of you done that before you go talk to them? Ouch. You see, that is respect God. And then in that, you can start to respect others. Not for who they are, of course not, but in who they were made by, the King of Kings. That's a boom shagalaga right there. The command is love God first. That is love up. And then second, love people. That is love out when you love up. You see, you can't love people sometimes if you don't start loving God first, right? Can I get an amen on that? Sometimes I have to go to God for my EGRs. That's the extra grace required people. You see? You can ask some of the people on our core team, right? When I don't. They come up and they challenge me, right? This is the pruning process as your pastor, the refining moments. And let me explain that. That doesn't mean, that it shouldn't mean being guilted into loving somebody. But you see, this is seeking the supernatural, the Holy Spirit, to help me with the EGRs. You see that? Look at John chapter 15, verse 12. This is my commandment, that you love one another. How should I love them? Just as I have loved you. You see, our love for others, without love for God first, we then won't have the love, the capacity to love like Christ loved, will we? And if we don't, then our words, our actions, even our prayers are meaningless, aren't they? What did 1 Corinthians 13 say? Even if I speak with the languages of angels, but do not have love, it's for nothing, Paul says. You know, sometimes I'll speak to people. They're frustrated about other people or about a situation they're in. And they'll say, I just want the best for them, Pastor. Or I don't want to see them have to go through X, Y, Z. But then they'll go into how they can't move on. And believe me, I get it. But I have also seen people loved out of hang-ups. I had this lady, Letty, she was wanting to go into ministry. I asked her if I could speak about her. She had some stuff in her life. Yeah, it wasn't good. There's another pastor that he spoke to me about the situation, and both of us said, yeah, we should let them go into ministry. But that we would be there and support, pray. That took about 2 years. And then that person came with us over here at MPC, and I spoke to her. Still had a little bit of that hang up in her life. But by then, you see, time had passed. Some encouragement had happened in her life with me and her. Prayer had happened. And you know, I challenged her. And she was able to hear me, listen to me. She was able to hear me because I was loving her, not condemning her. And that, my friends, is what it takes sometimes before correction. Sometimes it takes to love people out of it. Can I get an amen on that? That is, have you loved and have those in your life, are they at a place that they see you with them? Do they see you walking with them, shoulder to shoulder, loving, or is your love based on what's right? This is what is fair. This is what is needed. That's why 1 Peter 4:8 says, love covers a few, no, a multitude of sins. How many of you are embarrassed because of the things in your life? Sometimes it takes love. Hey, let's go have some coffee. Let's just go hang out. It's all right, man. I'm going to pray with you. I'm going to help you. How's that thing in your life? How's that thing in your life? So as we examine our own fruit, y'all aren't thinking about someone else, right? That's to examine your own doggone fruit. So first, examine your love for God. Second, examine your love for others, and especially the EGRs. And last examination of this love we'll see this morning is our love for our enemies. Oh, you have to go there, huh? Yeah. Boy, the pruning, the testing goes into high gear on this one. Love for enemies, doesn't it? Look at Matthew chapter 5, verse 43 through 47. I was talking to another ministry leader. I said, man, when you can quote straight from Jesus, use Jesus. I love Paul, don't get me wrong. But this is Jesus now. He says, you have heard that it was said, Jesus is saying, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, he's talking about the Levitical laws, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good and sends rains on the righteous and the unrighteous. That is, dude, life happens to all of us. I love Jesus and bad things happen to me. It happens to everybody. Get over it. Build a bridge. Verse 46. For if you love those, I love that question. Even Jesus says, it's up to you. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Because of course I love my wife. That's easy. Do not even the tax collectors do the same? That is, don't even the narcos even love their own people? That's what it says there. You see? If you greet only your brothers, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles, that is non-believers, do the same? And man, this is why I, like I said last Sunday, growing fruit is a process. It's at times very slow and many times painful, but necessary in our growth as Christians. Jesus loved even while going to and on the cross. This separates the men from the boys, for sure. Love your enemies, no doubt. If you don't start experiencing and loving up God, then out others, you won't have any experience to love the difficult things. You see? Let me remind you. Jesus says it's a thing that we must do. This isn't a suggestion to you. He says, but I say to you, love your enemies. Now let me give you some points to keep in mind when you encounter people, which I'm hoping you all encounter people in your life, and especially when encountering or having an enemy in your life. First thing to consider about love in your outline, love is a choice. Sometimes it drives me crazy when people want to get a divorce and they say, it's because I don't love them anymore. Oh no. How long did you love that toy in your life? Man, if you have kids, you know what I'm talking about. I got an iPhone. And then they get the box and they start playing with the box. What happened? Just the thing. Love is a choice. Remember John 15, 16 makes it clear. He chooses us. Why? Because of John 3, 16. For God so loved the world. See, he chose us. Love is a choice. Second thing about love, we must choose to accept God's love. See, love is a choice, and you have to, if you're going to start loving people, your enemies, you have to understand we must choose to accept God's love first. When you encounter the EGRs, love him, and then you can love him. You know, that is why coming to church doesn't make you a good person. It is accepting God, his love, that makes us loving towards others. We saw that already, right, in today's message. Third thing to understand about love, start to learn, start to put other people's needs before your own. Just put their own needs. Sometimes I'm asked as a pastor, hey, pastor, can we use your facility? Can we do? Yeah, man, you're going through a tough time. We'll help you. No big deal. Learn, just learn. And this will help you if you practice this on people before you do with your enemies. You know, I've had some people who at first didn't see a need. They didn't want to have people in their life, right? I'm cool to be alone. But that is not what we are to do, is it? And learning to put others first helps us in our growth process. Fourth thing to realize about love, realize that love is a process. It's a process. How many of you all who are married did not expect your marriage to be that way, but you're growing in love? Yeah, it's like, man, I didn't know we were going to have to do that. Thought it was just going to be pizza and fun all the time. We've got bills? Bills? What the heck's that about? It's a process. We need to buy this, and well, I spent it on that. Well, I love you. It's a process. It's a process. And I'm talking about me. Me and my bike stuff. You think I'm talking about Selena? Look, I bought this brand new bike. Ta-ding. Now remember, don't be thinking about someone else. Think about you in your life. Think about the EGRs, the enemies in your life. Are you allowing in your heart the process of love for them to work? Or are you putting them off for as long as you can? Or not seeking the process of the supernatural thing in you, the Holy Spirit? I had somebody come up to me and they're like, man, this guy, this person, ministry, they just don't want to talk to me. Man, just love them. It's all right, man. You're going to see. Just love them. They'll come around. And if they don't, there'll be another clown around. Don't worry about it, man. Fifth thing about love. Walk in the spirit of forgiveness. Boy, ask me and the deacons about that one. Like, okay, what did they do to the building? Walk in forgiveness. Walk in forgiveness. And this one here, this is huge. Look at Ephesians chapter 4, verse 32. Paul saying this to you about walking forgiveness. Be kind to one another. Just be kind. You can just stop there. Just be kind. Then you can start with tender-hearted, forgiving each other. Why? Just as God in Christ also has forgiven you. You see, that's the benchmark. And that is how you can not just love, how you don't have to just withhold, how you can start to seek to produce fruit when Jesus paid it all. I don't understand that sometimes. That our holy God had to pay such a brutal price and that you withhold love. That's why he says you are more than conquerors through Christ. And some of you are ticked off at somebody and you forget what he did for you. You see, that is, look at what he did, and now look at how you're acting. Why are you withholding? See, let's start to wrap this up. See, without God in our lives, without love for God first, the rest of the spiritual fruit then are just stuff that we can do. Right? We can fake it. I can fake it. I can use my earthly definitions, my earthly condition, predetermined conditions on love. I gotta love. I don't have to use the love of God. I can love. I love your enchiladas when you bring them. I have joy. I have peace. Patience occasionally. Kindness. I got goodness. Self-control. But listen, it is only through loving God that we can go to him knowing that this is a supernatural thing, this list that the Holy Spirit can empower us to do and be like Christ. Some of you are exhausted because you're using your own list. I'm going to church and I got to love on people. Ugh. See, without the genuine fruit of love, then your words are meaningless. Your very actions, your gifts to God, the acts of service, your sacrifices, they're all useless. That's why you're exhausted when you come to church. I don't want to help anymore. Just don't help. Don't worry. You see? Or are you serving? Because that's what we do as Christians. Are you serving, sacrificing, giving? Are you reaching out to others out of the love that you have for Christ? And if you aren't, you're going to get tired. So how? How do we as believers do this? You might say, okay, I see the need. I got to use this fruit in my life. I've sat here. I examined my fruit. I wasn't thinking of Uncle Bob. Well, look at Zechariah 4:6. Here's the first part of the clue. Not by might nor by power, not by this or by this, but by my Spirit, capitalized. That's by the Holy Spirit, says the Lord of hosts. That is, don't look at this list. Don't look at that first fruit, the one of the spirit of fruit of love, and then try to do it with your way of doing it. Love, joy, peace. No, how? Not by might, not by power, but by the Holy Spirit. That is, he empowers us. He's the one that comes alongside, the called one. Last, let's look at Luke chapter 11, 9 through 10. So I say to you, Jesus says, ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks it will be opened. And oh boy, that makes it and takes it to another level. You see, some of you have found me here on my knees praying when you walk in. And you know, it works. It works. Why? Because I'm a cool dude. Well, yeah, but I'm a cool dude. That doesn't make it. No. What did it say? It says seek, pray, grow, lean on God, and all who do will what? Look there, receives. You see, you can't do it by might and power, but when you seek him, he says you'll receive, you'll find. It is open to you. For the stuff that you want? No, for God to get glory, for you seeking his kingdom, his will. For God, boom. You see, love for God compels us to honor God and to honor him and to start loving out. Let's pray. Some of us, Lord, let's be honest, we've been doing it on our own might. We've been serving you and helping you. We've been reaching out to people and we put the nice voice on. But Lord, it is through seeking you first and loving you first that we can start loving others. And maybe you've examined your own fruit. And you see that, yes, this is something that you have messed up. That this spirit of fruit of love is something that you do to empower us to reach others. And you've thought about someone in your life or people in your life. And if that is you and you've kind of blown it, if you've been angry at God, maybe you accepted him, but you haven't really met the challenge of loving him. Maybe you have somebody in your life that you're just avoiding at all costs. And now that you can see that it's through the power of the Holy Spirit, praying and seeking him first, that you can have victory in those areas. And if that's you, with your eyes closed and with your heads bowed, everybody, close your eyes, bow your heads. That's right. Raise your hand if that's you. I see you guys. I see you guys. I see you. I see you. And just pray this to yourself as I pray. Lord, I'm sorry. I've blown it. I need you, but when I look at my life, I don't really need you. So, Father, forgive me that I made myself a God and took you off of being God. I'm sorry, Lord. Lord, you are the King of Kings. And I put myself as King. I've loved to hate my enemies. It feels good to hate. I'm sorry, Lord. Because you died for me. Forgive me, Lord. But Lord, I need you. I can't do it alone. I'm thinking of this person and it just makes me cringe. It makes my stomach turn upside down to think that I have to love them. Lord, I need you. Just give me the courage and the help that I need. Not to meet the challenge, but just to walk with you. And that supernaturally, you will help me through this process, Lord, of loving out. I thank you for who you are and what you did. And forgive me for making you less than who you are. It's in the mighty name of Jesus we pray. Amen.